Hey everyone, Rosseter and Fuge here. We are really happy with the response to the Real Silent Hill experience. We didn't realize it was going to get so incredibly big. Apparently, it's gotten so big that some of the big shots over at Konami have been watching it. Tom Hewlett, the producer of Shattered Memories, had this to say.
Devin Chatsky and I are both impressed by the production values on display in these videos. Clearly, a lot of time was spent planning and then creating this documentary. For the record, I do agree that Alessa's portrayal in those as evil rather than a victim trying to fix things is inconsistent.
Which is great. Lots of negative feedback too, though. The way some people are talking, you'd think we ruined their friggin' lives. So that's cool. We made this follow-up video as a thanks for all the feedback and also to answer questions and clarify our statements. So, first question.
Many people were asking us where we got the idea that Eddie shot a football coach.
The truth is, it doesn't matter who we said he shot, there were gonna be arguments anyway, right? Fact is, he shot someone that had some relation to football, and the speech they give shortly before this sounds like someone talking down to him, so the first thing that popped into our heads was coach.
When you first meet Eddie, he's in a bathroom across the hall from a room filled with football memorabilia and angry graffiti, which hints at a hatred toward anyone that has anything to do with football in general. The only reason we can come up with for that is that he tried to play, but was rejected.
You know, the dog he shot wasn't actually a dog, it was the team mascot. Hmm. He wanted to wear the costume. He was jealous of the guy because he got to wear the costume and hide inside it.
Oh, and you know that's not really American football? It's European football, you know, like soccer?
Soccer.
Yeah, he's all big and huge and everything. He can block balls and,
yeah.
You know, he's got
the backwards hat.
Mm-hmm, and the striped and shirt.
Striped shirt and the blonde hair.
Uh-huh.
I mean, come on, this stuff is so obvious. He's eating pizza in the bowling alley.
A couple of people still think Pyramid Head is not specific to James because Walter Sullivan was quoted shouting, "He's trying to kill me. He's trying to punish me. The monster. The Red Devil. Forgive me. I did it, but it wasn't me."
In Silent Hill 2, this is really meant as foreshadowing the Pyramid Head arrival. But when Silent Hill 4 was made, the explanation was changed to have Walter referencing his first victim, Jimmy Stone, whose nickname was the Red Devil because he was an executioner for the cult of Silent Hill 4. We would also point out that the book in Silent Hill 2, The Crimson Tome, refers to the cult's god as the Crimson One. This could also be an explanation.
People are still a little confused why we say all the strange happenings in Silent Hill are happening in no other than the real world. Tom Hewlett, the producer of the new games, was one of them. If Alessa triggered the darkness of Silent Hill, creating monsters for Silent Hill 2, etc., in the singular real-world dimension, how did James and Mary have a pleasant vacation stay there years later?
Tom, thanks for asking, but we did not say that Alessa was the direct cause of the manifestations. You need to go back and watch Part 11A again, where we said that the spiritual power surrounding the town is the cause of the manifestations, and that Alessa is what caused the spiritual power to become evil and related to the god. As for the manifestations happening in the real world, we refer you to Silent Hill 1.
Was I dreaming? Was that another dream? This is not a dream. It's being invaded by the other world.
And what is the other world, Harry?
By a world of someone's nightmarish delusions come to life.
When you think about what the Silent Hill series is really about, a spiritual power tainted by a crazy demon cult, then it's easier to see that the spiritual power is acting on the physical world, bringing to life pieces of dreams and thoughts. And your dreams and thoughts are not another dimension. When the power of the demon takes hold, crazy, crazy stuff happens, because time and space have no meaning.
If you don't agree, then that's fine. It's parallel universes or whatever.
People wanted to know how we got the idea that Samael is the god the cult initially worshipped. But we said the god presumably was Samael, because at that point in the game, that is what the players led to believe.
The password is presumably.
We never refer to the cult's god as Samael ever again in the video, but if you look up what Samael is, it's not such a stretch to believe that the cult could have at one time worshipped him. In Talmudic lore, he is known as the Accuser, Seducer, and Destroyer. The spiritual power was tainted to become related to the cult's god, so it makes sense because James meets all three. Angela, who is the accuser, Maria, who is the seducer, and Eddie, or Pyramid Head, who is the destroyer. That's not what we're saying, but it works, doesn't it? Something to consider.
The most common complaint that we get is doubt about the validity of our statements that the fire in the Gillespie house was an accident based on a certain memo that details a boiler explosion. That is a legitimate concern, considering that it challenges the universal belief that the cult set fire to the house and left Alessa to burn. When we discussed this in part 4, we said, if you go by what you learn in just the first game, there are many pieces of evidence to support that the fire was an accident. The most pertinent example would be a memo that is not available in either the North American or Japanese releases of the game. The memo was either inserted later or a faulty piece of code was fixed to enable it for the European release, which would indicate the importance of the memo. Otherwise, why bother?
Well, we're not ashamed to admit it. We made a mistake. As it turns out, the boiler explosion memo is in the Japanese release. In both European and Japanese releases, the 7-year-old newspaper clipping can be found on the third floor of nowhere after meeting certain conditions. As it turns out, it is the article that has been clipped out of the newspaper in the front office. You ever wonder where that article was? Now you know.
This leads us to believe that there was a coding mistake made on the North American version of Silent Hill, because this memo is not readable even after the special conditions. And yet the newspaper still hints at the article's existence.
The number one argument people make against this evidence is that it is contradicted in the Silent Hill Koshiki Guidebook Kanzenban, or Silent Hill Official Guidebook Complete, and also in Silent Hill Origins. Now, we fully intended to use the Konami guides in this video, but after discovering the truth about what was written in the Brady Games official Silent Hill 3 strategy guide, published by Konami, it was apparent that we could not accept any information from such guides at face value.
We wonder if the information in the Brady Games guide written by Dan Berlow is accurate because it contains similarities with his erroneous guide online written under the alias President Evil. You can find this guide on GameFAQs.com. When comparing the guides side by side, the inaccuracies are apparent.
Dahlia and the cult performed a ritual to summon their dark god Samael into material form. But the ceremony only conjured a child that contained half the soul of their dark god, and so it only remained dormant within the child. That child was Alessa.
Through magical conjuration, a fanatical sect within the order led by Dahlia Gillespie created a child named Alessa. Within this child was their god, an embryonic form, waiting for the right time and the proper age of the child so that it might be conceived.
So the cult locked her in her bedroom and set fire to Dahlia's house.
Dahlia locked Alessa in her room and set the house on fire.
For 7 years, the cult and Dahlia tried fruitlessly to teach the stubborn child to tap into the power she carried and to come to terms with her true purpose for living.
There are many instances when Heather expresses in her thoughts that Alessa was once a pious young girl devoted to the theology of the order and to carrying out her purpose in existing. This is the impression of Alessa that Claudia gained as well when the two were children. However, at some point, Alessa's thoughts must have secretly turned against the cult. Later in the Brady Games guide, Dan Berlew contradicts himself. Alessa was sharing her pain with the town of Silent Hill in a fit of horrific vengeance. The young woman attempted to suppress the evil within her by creating the seal of Metatron everywhere she went. Alessa was trying to stave off the birth of the god, although the monster within was now so powerful that it was transforming the town.
So which is it? Was Alessa spreading the nightmare, or was she trying to stave off the nightmare that the god was spreading? Which is it, same guide?
He also gets Douglas Cartland's last name wrong, calling him Douglas Cartwright.
Twice!
When asked about the writing of the guide by members of HellDescent.com, he stated, I wrote up a plot guide as usual and submitted it with the rest of my text. While I'm not sure what person exactly read through the guide, employees at Konami Japan did indeed read through the entire text and make corrections. That includes the plot guide, which I remember came back with heavy edits and even a few requests for rewrites. They made a few points a lot more vague than I would have liked, but I was still happy to finally have it be a part of the guide. They did indeed review the guide and approve everything that was said therein. They deleted some of the things I said, but I believe that was to make the interpretation more correct, not to keep things hidden. My only source for the information I put into the plot guides came from the games themselves. And yes, Konami made the final edits to the guide, with the exceptions of a few things I was asked to rewrite in order to meet approval. But in those cases, I'm always told how I'm wrong, if I'm wrong, so the printed version is right.
Originally, we thought that Silent Hill Origins appeared to be following Dan Berlew's plot analysis closely, since a few of the details, such as the nature of the house fire and the multiple rituals from the Resident Evil guide, made it into the game.
But Tom Hewlett says this: Konami has never used unofficial content as source material for any games.
Now we're more confused than ever, because Konami is apparently approving these inaccuracies, and this still doesn't explain why Origins is so similar to the Resident Evil guide. We don't know who's listening to whom, but we do know that no one is listening to Silent Hill 1. So, when making the video, we decided that any evidence taken from an official source would have to be from a member of the creative team or validated by a quote from a member of the creative team. A statement would be made, and then someone from the team would elaborate. Now that we've established, again, the rules that we followed during the production of the video, let's look at the guide that apparently contradicts us. The Silent Hill Official Guidebook Complete, specifically the Q&A session featured within.
The first thing we want to point out is that the guide's author is unknown. Who wrote it? Probably a third party, and the way that Dan Berlew is a third party. It is unlike any interview in the way that there is no actual quotes or confirmations from Team Silent members. Who is asking the questions and who is answering? Probably the author asking on the reader's behalf.
The next thing to point out is that people are not actually reading the official guidebook, but a translation of it. Now, we're not calling into question the validity of the translation. There are plenty of translation notes to indicate that the person that did it knew what they were talking about. That being said, the site says that the translation was checked and revised by somebody else, and there is a list of others who also made corrections. That doesn't necessarily mean it's wrong, but it's something to consider. Something else to consider is that the site says Koshiki, K-O-Shiki, while the book says Koshiki, with an elongated O-U sound, so in Romaji would be K-O-U-Shiki.